So hello, welcome everybody. Thank you for participating and giving us a little time to get our technology in order. Can everybody hear me okay with a thumbs up? Okay, terrific. So we wanted to give this presentation to give people a better sense of what is important when appealing your property taxes, assessment specifically. And there's some information out there, but nothing that's really geared towards Burlington. So we can take the opportunity to give you this sort of overview. So the first thing I'm gonna do is talk about what we're gonna talk about. So the first thing we're gonna talk about is the scope of the presentation. Then we're gonna go into the various property valuation and assessment techniques, including the cost approach, the sales comparison approach, the income approach, and also some special statutes that play in how things get set on the grand list in Vermont. We're going to talk about some timelines and deadlines, understanding the lister card, which is the basic document or information that the assessor has about each property that he uses to determine a value. We're going to talk about something called the diminishing cost curve, which is very important in property assessment. And then talk about specifically how to best make your case. And the two approaches we're going to look at is making your case using the cost approach, making your case using the sales comparison approach. There is a very important thing in Vermont law called equalization, and we'll talk about that. And then some very specific step-by-step appeal steps that you take to appeal your assessment.
Alan?
Yes.
Do you want to give introductions?
Oh, I'm sorry. I thought our names were spot on the screen. My name is Alan Bjerke, and I am a resident here at Burlington and currently the chair of the Burlington Board of Tax Appeals.
Okay. I'm John Vickery. I'm the Burlington Assessor, and maybe I've met some of you at certain times. But mostly, Alan put this whole production together. He did the lion's share of the work, but I think it's going to be very beneficial because we often have appeal hearings and people come in with the wrong sort of process, and we try to guide them in a different way, and we feel that if people have some tools, they'll be more successful, and also that we will have better outcomes. And that's the purpose of this. Thanks, Alan. Go ahead.
Okay. So, first, let's look at the very big picture, which is that taxation is generally has an analogy of the three-legged stool. So you have property and assets, you have income and transactions. So income is the income tax and various things tied to income. Transactions are everything from sales taxes to meals and rooms taxes, and property transfer taxes, and paying every time you got to register your motor vehicle. And then the government gets a lot of money, obviously, from the property stool, the leg of the stool. And so in Vermont, that's typically real estate and some business personal property. In other states, it could include luxury motor yachts and boats and RVs and cars and things like that. In Vermont, we're pretty much tied to the real estate. So the scope of this presentation, to be clear, is really directed towards homeowners. This is for single family residences, duplexes, triplexes, and condominiums. You could spend years studying property assessment, as John Vickery has, to learn all of the other techniques and nuances for the commercial and the farm and the industrial properties. But we're going to try and keep it focused on what people in Burlington would want to hear about, and that is homeowner orientation. So this is not a seminar or presentation on four or more residential units. That's considered commercial in Burlington. Commercial industrial farms, and also mobile homes are a special category that we're not going to touch on here either. So there's four basic approaches that are used. First is the cost approach. Second is something called the sales comparison approach. The third is the income approach. And then finally, there are special statutory sections that apply. So the first thing is stepping back, what does the state statute say of how we're supposed to value property for the grand list. And we're supposed to set them at fair market value. And the fair market value is the price that a property will bring to the market when offered for sale and purchased by another, taking into consideration all the elements of availability of the property, its use, both potential and prospective, any functional deficiencies, and the other elements such as age and condition that combine to give property a market value. Basically, when somebody would typically buy it for, somebody would sell it for in the free market. Interestingly, though, the statute goes on to say, in determining estimated fair market value, the sale price that a property actually sold for is one element to consider, but is not solely determinable. So sometimes we'll see, for example, somebody paid too much for property. They paid more than it was worth. There are reasons for that. And then sometimes we'll see, for example, maybe it was a transaction between friends or relatives or something like that. And that sale price does not determine what the value of the property. John, do you have anything to add there?
Yes, I think the important part of there is sometimes the sale is important if it's a fair market transaction, but it's not the solely determinative because you should be looking at other market indicators as well, other sold properties.
So let's first go into the cost approach. The cost approach is the most common form of setting value in the mass appraisal, or what we just went through in the reappraisal process. It collects multiple data points for both the land and the buildings that are being assessed. It includes the property location, the size of the property, the size of the building, the characteristics of each, and it applies an algorithm that has actually been tested against sales to come up with a valuation that is supported again by sales model. So I'll just take you a quick peek at the algorithm used in Burlington. This is the algorithm, and the point of this is really to say it's quite nuanced and there's quite a lot to it. And so a lot of times people come to us and say, well, apartments sell for $120,000 a bedroom downtown, so my property should be valued at X. And it's really a little bit more complex than that, and we'll get into some of that. But we just wanted you to see what the actual algorithm is, because it is quite detailed. Next, we'll look at the sales comparison approach to value. And in a sales comparison approach, you identify recent comparable sales that are bona fide arm's length transactions. So again, this is where the property was exposed to the market, somebody wanted to sell it, people looked at it, somebody decided to buy it, and they bought it for a certain price. Not interfamily, not transactions to convey property among partners or anything like that. The next step is to identify the critical components of each property. And then you evaluate the values of the components that are different between the comparable sale that you're comparing it to and your property, which is called the subject property. And then you estimate the sales price of the subject property by adjusting the sales price of the properties that sold to accommodate the differences. Now this is a lot of work, so let me just show you an example. If you've ever had a property appraisal done, for example, with the bank or that you're getting a mortgage loan or something like that, there is a report, and the report includes a sales comparison approach. So here, you can see my mouse moving, you have the subject property, which was 105 Old Fountain Street in this example, and it has various components about that property listed. And then you have three comparable sales, and this one is 13 Carew Street. The appraiser noted some differences. Oops. Sorry about that. So for example, here where the building size, the gross living area, was 162 feet larger for the property that sold for $250,000. They adjust that by taking the $250,000 subtracting $4,100 to figure out what that would be if the same buyer were to buy a house that had 162 less square feet. And they do the same thing for the fact that there's no basement in the first one, but there is one in the second one, and the difference between whether there's a wood stove or not a wood stove on that. So these are some of the critical elements that get evaluated. The next one is the income approach. And while we're not going to talk about how you do an income approach, it's important that you understand that the income approach is actually being applied in some of the properties that you're looking at when you're comparing other properties to your own. So the income approach is typically, in Burlington, used only for multifamily residential units or four or more units, because those are more typically bought by investors as opposed to someone who wants to live in it as their residential primary residence. It's typically used for commercial and industrial properties, and it's used by estimating the price that a property would sell for based upon the amount of income that it would produce for an investor that purchased it, and then applies a capitalization rate or a rate of return or a profit rate typical for that kind of investment. This is very important that you know that a property is being assessed using the income approach, because while the assessor's card may show a building and a land value broken out on the lister card, they're not accurate for comparing to other properties. I don't know how it gets in there, it's a little informational or something, but that's not what's actually used to determine the value of some property. And excuse me one second. I can show you an example of the perils of comparing an income approach property to one that is not under the income approach. This is a decision from an opinion that we made last year. We've had a couple of these. This is just an illustration of it. But the taxpayer in this case presented us with a commercial property with 26,000 square feet, where the land was assessed at $143,000. But their lot was only 4,000 square feet, and it says higher at $232,000. They said this just doesn't make sense. And it doesn't make sense if you think that the property that was 26,000 square foot was assessed using the cost approach, and that you're adding the building and the land value. Because they're done differently, you're just going to get yourself in trouble if you try to compare an apple to an orange in this situation. John, anything on those three approaches before we get into the complicated statutory one?
No, I think you're doing a good job. The income approach is done by apartment buildings and other commercial properties. And the cost approach was widely used for all other residential properties. The sales comparison approach was used when there was a review or an appeal as a review of how does it relate to the cost approach. I think that's what I would add.
So there is, of course, a saying that don't put life, liberty, or property to determine under the legislature's session. And when they come into session, they write these statutes. And so they have some specific carve-outs for particular properties and how they would like to see them assessed under the grand list. So you have perpetual lease lands, which are lands that are, you never own them, they're just perpetually leased. We have some of those in Burlington. They're much more common in some of the Mills Point, Colchester Point areas in Colchester. You'll see those. We have subsidized housing, which is the Section 8 housing and similar programs built by special rules. You have a statute dealing with housing subsidy covenants, or the land trust properties, what we think of here, that are both condos and houses. Solar panels and projects are treated separately. Current use is a very big issue in most of Vermont, Burlington, I think, only has two current use properties, so we're not going to spend a lot of time on current use here. And then veterans also get exemptions, and it's done differently from town to town. In Burlington, we don't actually change the assessment, it's, that's done on the tax bill. So veterans get an exemption of $10,000, and I think surviving unmarried spouses of veterans get up to $40,000. But you won't see that on the grant list here, you'll see that done in the tax bill in Burlington. So the most common ones that you'll see in Burlington are the statutory exceptions for subsidized housing. So this is where Invitational Square or Everhome or somebody like that has a property that has people in it that are rented to Section 8 or similar programs. So it's similar to the income approach, but the thing to be careful about is that it may be less than four units and still qualify. So if Invitational Square has a duplex, they're being assessed using a special model that is not the cost approach, similar to a privately owned duplex right next door. And then the other one that trips a lot of people up is the subsidy covenant property, otherwise known as the land trust property. That is basically, the legislature has determined that they should get a 30% or 30 to 40% discount on the assessed value of their property because it being a land trust property. So the key to make sure that you don't do is compare an assessment of one of these types of properties when you're looking at evaluating what's a fair assessment of your property. So how do you identify whether something is one of these kinds of properties? So on the lister card that we're going to talk about very soon, up in the upper left-hand corner, you'll have the name and address of the property and the property owner. And there'll be a statement that says land trust home in this block. So that means that that property is assessed using the special land trust formula and not the formula that's used for a regular single family home, or in this case, it's a condominium. An income approach property can have a special section on the lister card that has income approach. And this is not shown on any lister card that don't use the income approach. And then subsidized housing properties is typically you can only tell, I can only tell, John may have a special method, by who owns the property. So Cathedral Square, CHT, is probably under that. Everhome is sometimes the property owner could be, you know, something simple like Monroe Street LLC, but the mailing address is always 125 Bank Street, which is where Everhome is. John, do you have another special way to identify that on the lister card?
I have to say you'll notice those values are lower than the others. Yeah, that's it. Yeah, we have a code for them.
Okay.
Can I ask a question there? We just saw the lister card which showed here's a land trust property. What's the name of that field where it says land trust home?
I don't know what the name of the field is.
It says type below the address.
Yeah,
is
it's a
right?
Proper. It's a label for a property type and it's
great.
Below
Thank
the address.
You. That's all I needed.
Yep.
So when you're looking at why is it so difficult to come up with the right value for my property, there's some real practical considerations to keep in mind. There's over 10,000 property parcels in Burlington, and nearly every property is different. There are some places where entire tracts of homes are exactly the same, and Burlington is not one of those places. And even if you get into some of the larger condominium complexes, like Court of College Battery, or Westlake, or Riverwatch, there can be quite a difference in value between the second floor level of the house of the condo and the fifth floor level of the condo, or if it's facing west as opposed to east. So nearly every property is different. About 500 to 1,500 property transfers happen each year. Now that's not arm's length bona fide sale transactions, and somebody's got to go through, John's office has to go through groups and figure out which of those many transactions are just estate planning or some other reason, and which ones are actual exposed to market bona fide sales comparisons to use for their comparison purposes. Plus, there's about 1,000 zoning permits and 1,800 building permits issued in Burlington every year, and about 30% of those are for not small projects, for over 25,000. So somebody's got to evaluate and determine whether or not that makes a difference in what a property should be valued at. Market prices, of course, are constantly changing. And there's a change in desirability of certain types of property over others. Sometimes condominiums are more popular and increase in value faster than single family homes. Sometimes it's the other way around. So looking at the appeal time frame, we wanted to give this seminar now because it's very timely. The grand list got launched on May 5th, and so notices would have gone out to people saying that the value of your property changed, and they should be getting those around now. And so the deadline to file an appeal with the Board of Assessors is May 19th, or 14 days after the grand list gets launched, and that's just statewide. If you appeal to the Board of Assessors by the 19th and they hear your appeal and they don't, you're not satisfied with the outcome, you have up to 14 days after the decision by the Board of Assessors, which is a written decision, to appeal to the Board of Tax Appeals. And then we'll hear your case, and after that, once we issue a written decision and send it to you, you have 30 days after that, or within 30 days, to appeal to the next level, which is either the state or the Division of Property Valuation and Review. One thing that is important here is that you don't need to wait for any of these specific timelines, because what you see is just an error that you think that if the assessor was aware of it, the grant list could get fixed, or your property assessment could get fixed. And so that's why say you can come in and visit John anytime for staff and point out something about your property that you think should be affected. John, anything that you want to add to that time frame? I'm not exactly sure, for example, do they have to appeal to the Board of Assessors through the assessor's office, or can they just come to some open sessions? Can you talk about that?
Yes. Thanks for pointing this out. Right now is the open time to file an appeal, and the Board of Assessors will be hearing their appeals from the 23rd to the 27th of this month. And we have an online filing system, so you can go online to our website, look for the Board of Assessors appeal hearings, and you can fill your appeal out online by stating your name, your contact information, where your property is located, and the highlight the points of your appeal. And you can also attach attachments to it if you have evidence of, say, like an appraisal done by the bank, or other things that are helpful, photos, that type of thing. So we suggest that people do that. You can still do a walk-in during the hearings. However, if the schedule is full, you may not get heard. So we always try to encourage people to file online, memorialize the opportunity to have a hearing. But if there's time, if it's early enough in the year, we like to do a review ahead of time. And then if we agree and we make some adjustments, then you can withdraw the appeal. There's no, you won't need to move any further. And we also want to correct factual information. So that's the beginning point, is making sure that what is there is correct. And then after that, there might be a discussion or a disagreement or an agreement about the valuation. And you have to go to the Board of Assessors first to move on to the next, to, you can't jump the process. Okay. I'm all set.
Okay. No. So the first thing about understanding how the assessors value your property is to find your lister card and take a look at it. So the city's website, which is right here, burlingtonvt.gov. And in the upper section of the page, you'll see a tab for rental and property info. And so you select that button, and it brings you to a page where you can search for the property. You can search by address, owner name, parcel number, etc. Put in the address that you're searching for here, and search the property address. And then you'll bring up a card that has a lot of information. But one of the tabs at the top of that page is the assessor record card. So select that, and that brings you to your actual lister card or record card.
Can you go back a second?
Yeah, I was going to say, can I catch that? Where you?
Yeah. What is the?
Select the assessor record card.
To the right of city Burlington. The thing that the third thing that's circled. What does it say?
It says rental and property info.
Rental and property info.
And I apologize. I should have said this earlier. You're going to have access to this entire slide deck. It's actually on the assessor's website now.
Right.
Under the ad hoc reappraisal committee page. I'll try and make it a little bit more prominent somewhere, but. If you want to just get this quick overview and then go back and look at these cards or watch them online afterwards, you can actually look at all of these slides and print them out and have them.
Yeah. Alan, if I may add, two times a year we update the property data. So we just recently updated the property data last week because we put out 450 notices. And we also had, which takes a whole weekend, updated all the property record cards and put them online as well. And that takes a little more effort, but you'd be able to look at all your property data, all your neighbor's property data, hopefully sales, we always direct people towards sales, and then and you can print off your property record card and review that.
When you said you sent out 450 notices?
Yes.
This week,
this past
week.
I got
one of those, and why am I 450 special?
I don't know you specifically, but the changes that we've made are if people have had additions or renovations or have done
building
stuff.
Permits.
Yeah, it's usually because of that. It's okay. Not a special reappraisal. That was last year.
Okay.
So.
All right. So once you identify and look at your lister card, we're going to take a look at the various parts of it. So this is the first page of it, the front page. And this is my lister card, actually. So in the upper left corner, you have the property address. And all the way on the top right, you have the final assessed value, which is determined from the building and the land and the extra items that are in the table to the left of that. And then you have a land section here. We're going to go into this land section in more detail. But one thing that I want you to note here is where the cursor is pointing there, that LDT9, that is the assessment district that we're going to be talking about in a minute. And that's exactly where you find it in this card. One thing that we want to point out, though, is that there is a comparable sales section on the lister card. And this confuses a lot of people because it's not the sales that were used to determine your building or your property value. This is something that is some research data or something, maybe John can explain it better, but these are not the actual sales. So if you go look at those sales, you won't be satisfied that they establish the value of your property. That's an aside. I talked about the assessment districts, and the city is divided into various areas that have some unique features to them, or some characteristics that are similar to their neighbors. And so, for example, if you look at the city here, the Old North End, it has a slightly different value than the Northern Hill section, or the Southern End districts. Or one thing that's important to see here is where the cursor is here in the south end, that's the WF10, the waterfront 10. See, that's the waterfront properties down at the Brown South Cove. And then here when you get into the new north end, all along Crescent Beach and Apple Tree Point, properties just because of sales and statistics, they sell for values that are different than, you know, half a mile away in the New York Bay. And so those districts are an important part of what sets the sort of base value for the land itself, and has some influence on the building value as well. John, anything you want to add on that?
No, you did a great job. I would suggest if you're looking for sold properties, try to look in the neighborhood that where you reside, or where the subject property is.
Alan,
one quick question. Those land assessment districts, since no reassessment had happened for 16 years, were the same land assessment districts the basis of the 2005 assessments, or have they changed for the reassessment in 2021?
Well, I can answer that. The assessment districts, by and large, stayed the same. What we wanted to do was combine some of them that were very similar and also in the same location, because I think they were too broken out in the past to run statistical measures. So we did some combining of certain areas. And, you know, if you're looking for a house in the South End, you're looking for a house in the South End, not necessarily one particular area of that area. So, and it's really based on valuation and property makeup and school district and those things that lead to the values for those areas. So your answer is yes and no on some level. There was a little bit of tweaking and some analysis but by and large, they are similar to what they were.
Right, the houses haven't moved, but some of the districts have been combined.
Yeah, there's been, I mean, we've seen some gentrifications in some areas and development in other areas. Yeah.
So while there's general homogeneity within a district, there are also something that on the board at least we call sub-districts. So there's some areas that just by nature of where they are get change in value from the basic base value for that assessment district. And so I live in one of those, Lakeview Terrace. So Lakeview Terrace in the LVP9 district, which is right here, which has a large mass, but is really Lakeview Terrace, and it's going to take in Cambrian Rise. In the LVP9 district itself, there's a difference between whether you're on the west side or the east side of Lakeview Terrace. So an east side has the basic rate of the LVP9. And what you're seeing here is on the west side, all of the properties on the west side have this positive influence of 70%, because the sales demonstrate that properties on the west side sell for more than the ones that are on the east side. A similar situation is in the Five Sisters neighborhood. If you have a house on Catherine, Charlotte, Carolyn, Margaret, or Marion, the mere fact that the address itself is one of those addresses drives people to your door to buy it and pay more for it than, for example, Hayward Street, which I think is just as nice a street. It doesn't get the same sales prices that the Five Sisters neighborhoods do. And so when you're looking at something's value of a comparable property that you think might be comparable, take a look at these to make sure that you're comparing apples to apples, because sometimes the sales comparisons may be quite different.
John, I can't quite read. Is there a way of identifying the geography of those neighborhoods? Is it on that sheet, or is there a map?
Well, he was showing a map earlier.
But these sub-neighborhoods, these sub-districts.
Yeah. No, they're not separated out.
Okay.
What we found is that certain, there's little areas that are a little more desirable,
right,
it, within the overall area of the assessment district, so to speak, which is kind of like the neighborhood. Well
and
put.
So sometimes it's an entire street or an entire side of the street, and sometimes it's particular to a particular property. So properties can have slopes, ravines, wetlands, floodplains, proximity to economic detriment. Like if your house is across the street from the steel generating plant, it's not going to have the same value as a property that is, you know, even 4 or 5 blocks away from that. So here's an example that we have of the east side of Common Square. People are familiar with Common Square. It's up against the Intervale, and so their lots tend to go back down the hill into the Intervale. So much of their property is not buildable on. And so it's not fair to assess them where their prices wouldn't get the same as if it were all one level building lot. But the property is not valueless. The property, by its nature, contributes to additional coverage they can have on the buildable part. It's very helpful to not only occupy land and keep other people from occupying it and block your view and things like that. So there is a change in value, reduction in value in this case. But it's not 100%. And then here's another example underneath there is Elbow Street. Does anybody know where Elbow Street is in Burlington?
No.
I've seen an arm, but they may be scratching their head.
I'm scratching.
So Elbow Street is all the way out North Avenue, past Plattsburgh Avenue, you're on North Avenue Extension. You turn left at the water treatment plant and go across the bike path and down into the lake. And this particular property, when I say into the lake, it floods a lot. And so, again, it's not valueless. You can put an RV there for 3 or 4 months out of the year and live right on the lake. But it doesn't have the same value as another property in the New North End one that that you could build a year-round house without worrying about it flooding. So that's talking about the land side of the lister card. Look at the building side now. Here you'll see on the top left corner you have the building style, which is important for starting a base rate of what the property should be valued at. You have something called building quality and building condition that we're going to go into much more detail about. And then you have building components, how many baths, how many half baths, how many kitchens, how many fireplaces, what is the quality grade of the kitchens, the bathrooms, things like that. So you also have a building sketch and a floor calculation area. And so one of the things we're going to talk about is correcting the data that the assessor has. This is a good place to make sure that that's correct. Because people sometimes do additions, or they were going to do an addition and they didn't. And so they got a zoning permit that never got done. This is an important thing to make sure that this card is correct, because that drives a lot of what the assessor's evaluation is. So I said the building style matters in setting the base. So here is the table that is used to set the base in Burlington. And you can see that a penthouse condominium at $150 or $120 per square foot starts at a higher base than a ranch, which is maybe under $60. A lot of them are right around that $60 figure, so it's not a huge driver necessarily of what the building value can be. And then the components captures these critical elements of the property that are used in that output that we saw at the very beginning. And then the building sketch in sub area captures the square footage and the value for those square footage. And what you can see is that an unfinished basement contributes very little value compared to a finished first floor. And so getting those things accurate is part of the best way to make sure that your assessment is correct. Now, all of those things get put into that algorithm, and there's something called the count ladder, which shows on the Lister card. What's very important to understand about this is that it includes a lot of information. It shows a lot of information that is helpful to understanding different steps of the calculation, but all of the figures of the calculation aren't there. So you can't, don't be frustrated by trying to multiply things and coming up with everything that's shown on the count ladder. This is, again, just a subset of some of the information that goes into what the cost approach is determining is your value. So, this is a very important topic that that we deal with a lot in support of tax appeal, and it's something that is common in a lot of commodity facts, which is that once you get to a critical size, enough land to have a building lot, enough house to have a kitchen and a bathroom, additional units of size increase the value of the property, but the incremental value of each additional increment is less than the prior one. The result is that you end up with a lower average value per total unit, which is called the diminishing cost curve. So again, a lot of words, a great example is simply this. You can go to Fletcher and buy a 1 acre building lot for $25,000. You could buy 100 acres of very similar land and it only costs you $100,000, which is only $2,000 per acre. So understand that that is happening both with your land size when you're comparing a lot that is maybe 5,000 square feet to one that is 10,000 square feet, and also building size. So comparing a property that has 2,000 of finished square footage, the one that has 4,000 square foot. The building value should be higher, but the price per square foot is going to be lower. So the assessor's office uses a table that is derived from sales experience. You can either try to create your own table and list it, or you can just use properties that are very similar to yours in terms of building size, both finished and unfinished, and then land size. John, I'm sorry to lose my voice, so you may want to do this.
Sure. You're doing such a great job. There's nothing to add. But that's a great example. We often get folks that come in and they say, they use the price per square foot analogy, and I say, well, your house is 1,000 square feet and you're comparing it to houses that are 2,000 square feet, and that's why they have a lower price per square foot, but they have a higher value. So I encourage them to try to find other houses of the same size, but there's a lot of other factors, unfortunately, that go into valuation. Quality, condition being major, and components. And location, of course.
So how do you make a persuasive case on appeal? Either to the Board of Assessors, to the Board of Tax Appeals, or the Division of Property Valuation and Review. So one approach that people use is to challenge the uniformity of the cost approach outcome. And this is where, again, where we're talking about challenging the price per square foot, land, finished space, standard valuations of amenities. They basically come down to, my neighbor's house is nicer, but valued less. Why? Challenging your assessment by comparison to the assessment of other properties is generally the least successful path. And why is that? First and foremost, most people come in with a table or a chart that shows four or five or six, maybe 10 elements of the property, and they're comparing them. And as you saw from the assessor's algorithm, there's many, many more things that go into it than three or four elements. And so our belief is that if you included all of the elements for each of the properties, the result would be comparable, be consistent. It's also the us from using the assessed value of somebody else's property to determine the fair market value of your property. Fair market values are determined from sales of property. The assessed value is not, confusing, but it's not something that can be used to value your property.
Excuse me.
Another approach is
John?
To, yes.
There's
where does, is this what's called equalization, and in what form, if ever, does that apply?
No, we'll talk about that soon.
Okay.
Yeah, we get the equalization soon.
Okay.
So another way to appeal is to correct the listed part. This is using the cost approach for your benefit. This is typically the easiest and most effective route, actually. Identify any incorrect data on your listed card, document anything that's different. There's something that's steep, unbuildable, or hazardous on your land. Identify zoning permits that have been pulled but not performed. That is often the case of they think you have a sunroom and you never built them. Identify elements that have been removed. We have people come in and say that pool has been there for a couple of years. Well, so show us a photograph and that gets easily fixed. You can also reevaluate the building grade, condition, and resulting depreciation. It's a little complex. We're going to get into that in more detail. But don't be surprised if you want to say that something isn't there, like a pool, and somebody wants to come see. That's John's job. That's our job. Keep that in mind. So, correcting the listed cards for grade, condition, and depreciation. This is going to be a little bit of a vocabulary lesson. Grade is the quality of building construction, and it helps determine the base cost that you start with when determining the value of a building structure. And there are several different grades. Here are some examples of the definitions of different grades. But it starts with very good grade. Actually, I think there's an excellent or custom about this. Then you can see it go down to average, fair, and poor. And so you can read those definitions and try and determine what is most appropriate for your property. Condition is the extent of deterioration of the building. So some buildings are very well maintained, and some buildings have not been as well maintained. And so the condition of a building is something that determines the degree of deterioration or depreciation of a building. So the depreciation is determined by a table, which is here up on the City Assessor's website, where at least it's in the ad hoc reappraisal committee section of the appraisal website. But the assessor takes a table and says, what is the condition and how many years old is the property? And that determines the level of depreciation. So a couple things. Number one, the depreciation maxes out at year 50. So there's no difference in the depreciation for a building that is 70 years old and one that's 100 years old. And that's kind of makes sense for building trade.
Maxes out at what age? What do we max out at? What age?
50 years.
50 years, okay.
Yep.
So the depreciation and those items are shown here on your list your card. So this is the building side, and it shows the grade of this building is good, the building condition is good, and the resulting depreciation, and the year built, the age built, the resulting depreciation is 22%. So here you take the undepreciated value, multiply it by 22%, you get $167,000 of depreciation for a resulting depreciated value of $595. So you can see that a few percentage point difference here can make a good difference on the bottom line. So it's important that we get these correct. And it's also an area that is often quite gray. John, anything you want to add about the color of this issue?
Yeah, the building grade is workmanship and materials and how it's built, and that's a quality grading, and that that matters for value. Condition also as well, that is wear and tear, overall physical condition. If you were to go back a slide, most houses have 30% depreciation if they're over 50 years old and they're in average condition, and that is applied. If there's renovations and is better than the typical of the area, then it would be bumped to maybe good or very good, or if it's showing more than the average wear and tear. I think the definitions that you had earlier, our averages in Burlington, our houses need a little more work than the typical, than what that statement shows. But you get the gist of it. The definitions, you can kind of get a sense of where your physical depreciation should belong, and we can review that and hopefully get it right.
One question. This idea of the grade, the quality of materials and workmanship, who determines that if nobody ever comes out to see my house? How is that determined, the quality and grade of workmanship and materials?
Well, we'd be happy to come out and see your house if you'd like. Typically what has happened is it was determined earlier at some other point, and houses don't change dramatically regarding its overall quality unless there's been extensive renovations and so forth and updating. Physical condition can change quite a bit, but usually houses stay about the same quality for a long time, but they can change a little bit as well.
So the building permit that got pulled, your office looks at the kinds of materials and the rating of the quality of workmanship of the contractor?
We kind of look at it as an overall. We're not making 25 checkpoints.
Right.
It's more of a general overview. Hi.
Does what we're talking about here apply only to the building or also to elements on the property like concrete slabs and steps and that sort of thing? Stone walls?
This is referring to buildings. We're focused on the building right now. I think Alan will go ahead and we'll answer questions towards the end. Okay.
So again, that is the approach of using the cost approach to your benefit. Identify things that you think that if the assessor knew that he would change his opinion of the value of the property. Next is the sales approach, sales comparison approach. So there's a couple ways to do the sales comparison approach. One is to hire a professional expert, and there are two of them that we see most often. One is a fee appraiser, like the person, whoever came out with the bank, if you mortgage your property and you sent a fee appraiser out, they prepared a professional fee appraiser report, and people submit those to us, and that is a valid sales comparison approach for the most part. You can also have a realtor provide an opinion of value, and these are often very valuable, but it's much more helpful if your realtor is, for example, very familiar with a particular condominium complex. They can say, been in the 12 units sold in the past 18 months, and this one is here in that spectrum. You can also just have a realtor put together a package that doesn't do much analysis at all, and that may give us some information, but much more persuasive to have something that has particularized information about the property that's been sold, and they're very similar to your You can also do it yourself. And so we're going to talk a little bit about how you can do it yourself. You'd want to identify comparable sales to use. You want to identify the components of each of those properties that sold, as well as your subject, and then adjust for the differences between the your property and the comparable sales. So where do you find comparable sales that are most relevant? So the state of Vermont Department of Taxes has a listing of all of the arm's length transactions in the past, I think, 3 years. Obviously, the last year or 2 years are more relevant than something 3 years out. And you can find them here at the State of Vermont Tax Department of Taxes website. And there's three tabs that go to the middle one and select that, and you'll get a report of all of the arm's length transactions in Burlington for the past 3 years. You can also find them with the more recent property transfer tax returns that are filed in City Hall. Make a chart similar to the one that the bank appraisers made, and identify the key components, ascribe reasonable values to the differences, be able to explain why you think the fireplace is worth $2,000 compared to the one without a fireplace, and make the adjustment, and take a look and make sure that your adjustment isn't too large. So you're not saying that something that's sold for $250,000 means that yours is only worth $150,000. That'd be a very large adjustment, and if it's not within 10%, you should probably look for other comparables, something that is more likely to be comparable. So this is the city appraiser example. When the city does, when the city assessor does a sales comparison report, this is what his looks like. And it doesn't have as much detail about how the values are different, but if you learn how to read it, that is what it's showing, is the difference between the comparable sale and how it affects the resulting value of the total value. So we talked. Yes, I see a question.
Could you go back to this? Could you go back to the slide where you showed the actual URL for the state of the Department of Taxes website where we can look for the comps? Thank you. Reports and comps.
Yes.
Got it, thank you.
Again, this presentation is online on the Assessor ad hoc website. So we said we talked about equalization. Probably the best way to describe it is in the Cacciadorian versus Town of Woodstock case. The board, meaning us, determined the listed value. We need to make sure that the listed value, meaning what it said on the grand list ad, corresponds to the listed value of comparable property. And this is a two-step procedure. First, we determine the fair market value of the subject property. And then next, we need to equalize it to ensure that the property is listed comparably to other properties in town. So for example, if all of the properties that are selling for $100,000 are listed on the grand list at $90,000, then your property should be listed at 90% of the fair market value. So that is equalization. And equalization is important to note, is for the entire class of property. So sometimes people will come in and say, I have six examples of where the property sold at 75% of or was listed at 75% of what it's actually sold for, so the equalization rate must be 75%. And the courts have determined it has to be a broader pool than that. Basically, all of, if you're comparing a single-family house, it has to be all of the single-family home sales in the community. That rate is available on the state's website again. In that same place that the sales were, it's the box that's above that. You can get the equalization rate for any town. And by the way, this works for any town in the state. It's not just Burlington. And so that's one place to get it. The assessor's office may have a more current ratio, particularly since this is published in December. And so by June or July, you may want to check with them and see if they have a different rate that they are using. John, do you have anything that you want to comment about equalization?
No, it's nice that you're showing an independent resource. We work with the state of Vermont for education funding on all the sales in, that occur in Burlington, and they run their equalization study for purposes of education distribution funding throughout the state of Vermont. So they do it for all the municipalities in the state of Vermont, and it helps with who's paying what, how much money is going to be received by every town, and so forth. Their study, I'd have to point out, is a little bit of a lagging indicator. The market is, as we know, right currently, has been moving quite dramatically in the upward. So I think it's a lagging study a little bit, but it is helpful to get it from another outside source. And then we may say, yes, good, but we know a better ratio, or we've come up with a certain ratio. But they're going to be similar. Most likely.
Okay. So if you've decided, hey, I think I should appeal my assessment, what are the steps that you would take? So first and foremost, gather your information, review your listener card, understand the information that the assessor has, and then identify how you want to go about presenting an appeal. One is, like I said, use the cost approach to your benefit. Identify incorrect data on the listener card and come forward and tell us where it's incorrect and why it should make a difference. The second is to pursue the sales comparison approach, either through a professional or by yourself, in which case you want to identify and document the comparable sales that you think should affect your case. And then prepare your case. Have it drawn out exactly what it is that you think the difference is and how you would show it. And then you would file a notice of grievance with the Board of Assessors, again, in this year, by no later than May 19th, to be assured of getting it to the pool of assessors. So when you appeal to the Board of Assessors, John, I'll let you take over of who's on the board and how that process typically works.
Okay. So we hope that people that want to appeal file online. We get the information in a spreadsheet. We contact folks. We schedule them, and we'll be start scheduling next week. Hopefully, we'll reach out to some people that have filed and be able to meet with them more informally, but the board right now, there's a vacancy for one person to be on the board, and the other person's been on the board about 5 or 6 years now, Jonathan Chapel Sokol, who is a retired IBM engineer. He's very fantastic, he loves statistics. And what we do is we have a hearing, it's casual. We ask for information, we review the property record card, and then we go and we conduct a review based on the information that we have. And oftentimes we do additional review anyways. We start looking at sales ourselves. We don't want to do all the work. We want the owners to come in with some evidence other than just, I want to appeal my property value. And then in mid-June, probably actually towards the last week of June because of the workload, we send out a notice of here's our decision. We have tried in the past, the last year it was too busy, but to actually write up a write-up about our review and our findings. So you get more than just here's the new value or here's the no adjustment and no reason. And then you have 14 days to move to the next level if you decide to. Most people are satisfied and they don't move on. That's that process. And then if you do move on, you might meet Alan across the table. And that's more quasi-judicial.
Right. So we're not terribly formal, but we are more formal. We are a quasi-judicial hearing. And so if you're dissatisfied with the decision by the Board of Assessors, you can file appeal to the Board of Tax Appeals with either the city clerk's office, or there may be an online portal. I'm not sure if that's going to get set up this year. The board is made up of 7 residents of Burlington, and we come from a variety of backgrounds, homeowners, apartment owners, investors, realtor, just a variety of people who are appointed by city council with the mayor presiding. And we do have 1 vacancy on the board this year, coming into this season. The initial submission is, well, the process is that we would get your notice of appeal and we would set a formal hearing date. And so you would hopefully get notice of that at least 30 days before the hearing. And then you're required to submit what you want us to review at least 10 days before your hearing. So you get a couple of weeks to get it together and send it into the city clerk's office. And then the assessor will review what you submit, and no less than 3 days before the actual hearing, he will submit a response, and you'll get the response to look at before you come to a hearing. So when there is a hearing before the board, the witnesses are sworn, it is more formal. Each side gets up to 10 minutes each to present what they think we should know about how to value the property. And at that meeting, we'll decide whether or not a site visit is appropriate. And if so, we'll schedule a site visit at that time to actually come and walk the property and look at it. Now, one thing that comes up is, what happens if you file a deal and you don't attend the hearing? If you don't attend the hearing and you don't tell us that you withdrew in advance, then we're going to value the property. And if it's something that's very simple, like, you know, being assessed $10,000 for a pool that hasn't been there for a year and a half, and even if we do a site visit and we see it's not there, you didn't need to be present to get what you want. But the value can go up, down, or stay the same. So it's important that you know that when you attend the hearing, doesn't result in a default of your appeal is dismissed. We will go ahead, we're required by law to go ahead and make evaluation as though you were there. And then finally, we are required to get our decision done and submitted by December 31st. So if the appeal from the assessor's office comes to us in July, then we hear those cases in the fall, and we get a decision out before the end of the year. If you're still not satisfied with the Board of Tax Appeals decision, there are 2 steps. There's step 4A and 4B. So it's a fork in the road. You get to decide whether or not you want to appeal to the Department of Taxes, the Property Valuation and Review. The notice of appeal needs to be filed within 30 days of the decision by the Board of Tax Appeals, accompanied by a payment of $70. You can expect to have a status conference with a hearing officer who is a Vermont real estate appraiser. Is that correct, John? They're currently licensed, or are they former sometimes?
They all have, they're not licensed, but they are appraisers. They've taken the courses that they need to take. It's not a license required position.
So the Department of Taxes has a panel of hearing officers that they accept them to the panel and make it assigned to these cases. You can expect a status conference with them, perhaps a site visit, which is, I believe, optional at that stage. Then there would be a final hearing, trial, where you put on your evidence of what the value of the property should be, and then a written decision comes from that. The alternative is to go to the Superior Court. So you would file to go to the Civil Division of the Superior Those appeals, again, need to be filed within 30 days of the decision from the Board of Tax Appeals, accompanied by a payment of $295, the current appeal fee. You can expect that they'll start with a status conference, everybody in, trying to figure out what they need to do to resolve the case. Each side can conduct discovery by requesting the other side to answer questions or present documents. There will be a trial, just like on TV, a trial, and then the court will issue a decision. And either the decision of the Superior Court or of the Division of Property Valuation and Review can be appealed to the Supreme Court. So you can make this go a good long time if you're really focused on that.
Waste your whole life.
Yes.
Does landscaping influence the value of the property?
It can. Sure, John, go ahead.
That's a good question because there's a certain amount of landscaping that we put an overall value on property when we do a land value, and it's typically includes, it assumes some landscaping, assumes grass and so forth and so forth. And if it's an undeveloped lot, we usually knock that value down a little bit because it doesn't have the landscaping. If it's extensive, we don't have a factor for landscaping. We don't break it out into pieces. Well, you've got some nice bushes and you have a fence. We don't have assessment on that. That helps.
But there is a special yard item.
Yep.
Element.
Yes.
So if you had a large waterfall or something like that, that would certainly get added in probably.
Yes. There's built-in adjustments for sheds and things like that.
Right. So pools. What is the impact of a final determination? So you appeal, you get a result. Again, important to note that final decision can be higher, lower, the same as the current assessment. Your tax bill will be retroactively revised for the affected year. So if we don't make a decision until December 31st, and your assessment started back in July 1st, so you've made your August and your November payment, you can anticipate that if there was a change, you would get a revised tax bill sometime, hopefully in order to make a correct payment for the March tax payment. So you should continue to make payments as they were, and if your rate went down, then your last two payments will be less. And if your rate went up, then your last two payments would be higher. And it is important to notice that future appeals are limited by the city charter. So there's a provision of the city charter that says that the decision of the Board of Tax Appeals, if not further appealed, or if further appealed and found to be valid, affect not only the grand year, the grand list for the tax year in question, but also the subsequent 2 years, unless there's been a substantial change or a reappraisal. So that pretty much wraps up what we wanted to say today. There are some additional resources that are out there. Again, this presentation will be posted at the city's website under, I know it's the assessment page under the ad hoc subpage. It may be other places later. The Vermont Secretary of State's office has a lot of resources for how to appeal your property tax and how to hear appeals as a board of civil authority or as a board of listers. So it's the same information, and you get to see both sides of the table and figure out where you want to be. The Vermont Department of Taxes also has video seminars on how to appraise property under Vermont law for the grant list. Listers in many towns are elected officials, and so they get their training from the Department of Taxes, and they post their training seminars on the website. So thank you all for coming out tonight. Thank you for bearing with the fact that I'm visited by our dear friend Mr. COVID, and I did want to share him with you. Thank you. And be there in person. But do you have any other questions? Now would be that time.
I'd like to know how often there will be new assessments in the future, like every 3 years, every 5 years. Do you have a plan?
Yeah, the last one was too long. According to state statute, it's based on statistical measures, and if you don't meet certain statistical measures of equity, then you're mandated. And then you may get mandated, but then you have to go through a whole process of finding a company to conduct the work, and then they may be 2 years out. So it's a long process. I'm hoping that we have more frequent reappraisals so that they're not as difficult. More frequent reappraisals, although it adds more work up front, it makes things a lot easier. Who knows, maybe the law will change or something will happen. We'll have to do them every 5 years. I would welcome that. And that would be better. There's some states that do them every year, some states that do them every 3 years, and others, state of Vermont only does it when you don't meet certain statistical measures. What we did last reappraisal in 2005, I'm making a long story longer, we were in an up market, and then the market dipped slightly and stayed steady for a handful of years. And then it started edging up, and then more recently it just really exponentialed up. And so that's when we did the reappraisal at that point, we were told to do the reappraisal in, I think, 2017, 2018, somewhere around that time.
Okay. In relation to that, the timing of the reappraisal, it was my understanding that there was some balance to be made between the commercial property assessments and the residential property assessments. And the data that was used on the commercial property assessments was the worst year that ever happened. It was 2020, when half the businesses were closed. So my understanding is that the commercial values, by and large, all decreased, while the residential values, to a large extent, increased. And has anything been done to try to correct that inequity?
Well, first off, your perception is a little bit flawed, and it's a little bit right at the same time. The market did increase. The market for residential properties have been increasing since 2010, but it's been accelerating more recently. So that is just a fact of the market demand, lack of supply, rates, mortgage rates going down. Right. Commercial properties tend to appreciate over time at less than single family homes. So even if we had done the reappraisal in 2017, 2018, there would still be some adjustment. There would still be some appreciation of commercial properties, but not to the extent of residential single family homes, condos, and so forth, duplexes. Some commercial properties were not affected by technically COVID at all. Some types of properties were. Office buildings were, retail was, movie theaters, others that were not affected at all.
Drug stores,
that's correct.
That's the only ones that weren't affected.
Industrial. Hotels were greatly affected. And those values should reflect what they would sell for at the time of the reappraisal, April 1st, 2021. The uncertainty in the market would dampen those values. That said, we have made efforts to revalue a lot of those properties, and we surveyed them, and if there was a hearing, we asked them, has your property had a cash flow? Because they're based on value, they're based on the cash flow to value.
Right.
Has your rental rates been adjusted? Have you had greater than normal vacancies? Are your expenses higher? We asked those questions, and we adjusted values based on that. We have adjusted all of those properties this year from a list that we have. We reviewed all of them and we sent out new income and expense forms, received a whole bunch of them, not 100%, of course, and we've made adjustments to them overall.
For the commercial properties?
Commercial properties. But we did not revalue all the commercial properties this year. But we did value some of the ones that were truly affected, all the hotels, some of the retail on Long Church Street had no effect, so to speak, in their rents. They were fully occupied during the whole time. They might have had some PPP money, but others actually had some vacancies and they noted it to us. And so we went back and we checked, how's your occupancy now? How's your cash flow? And we have adjusted those upward because now they're stabilized again. We looked at it.
But not adjusted the residential portion downward to balance out the increase in commercial.
No, we're not adjusting the residential after 1 year. We're basically doing a second reappraisal. No. That would cost another $1 million. Sir, no, I'll get you next. Whoever, who would like to speak?
If I'm trying to do a self-done assessment and with sales comps.
Yeah, thank you.
Am I looking for a value as of today or a value as of the reassessment of 4/2021?
Well, ideally, state law would be as of today, April 1st of each year, would be the most ideal.
And then if I'm trying to differentiate between properties,
yep.
I look at the value of my home, I look at the value of reasonable comps, then you suggested if we're going to do that, then we adjust for differences. Do you publish any table that says something like, if it's air conditioned or not, adjust this much. If it's like this, adjust that much. Is there anything that can help me look at features and have a sense of how much to adjust?
Yeah, that's the challenge when you're not, I'm sure you're an expert in many things, but you're not an expert in valuations. Like, how do we do it? What do you do here? Some of the biggest components would be like quality, condition, size, and location. Other things matter less. They still matter, but other things matter less. And so if you hit the bigger points, making adjustments for differences, that's the best thing you can do. But the most similar properties are the best, and you can suggest, look at the sale of this particular property. Mind you, our difference between, if you're talking about single family homes now, they're at about 90% of market. Over the course of this past year, they've gone up about 10%. So we would look at how recent the sales are and adjust for time, and then we would equalize that because it's not fair to reassess you at today's market. We need to equalize it to the reappraisal year, basically April 1st, 2021, or basically apply that downward factor. If you want to use sales right around the reappraisal date, then without adjusting, we could look at that. And you can look at it different ways, but the courts would require you to look at it as of April 1st, what's the market value, and what's the equalization that should be applied. But I don't think, most people don't go to court. They come to us, and most cases are resolved.
So the four big things were quality, condition, size, and location.
Yeah. There'd be some other things too, like is the basement finished or is there an attached garage or no garage, you know, that things like that as well.
The thing that I would add to that, Tom,
yeah.
Is, there are certainly tables of how much certain things cost and whatnot, but it's really a matter of if you come in with a reasonable argument, and that is what is going to be persuasive. So I wouldn't spend a lot of money or effort. Just be reasonable. So, you know, you have people on the board of tax appeals that are realtors, that are builders, that are investors. And if you come in and say that you're you know, over your little hockey ranch in the New North End needs a new roof, and that's $90,000. We're not going to find that good reason. But if you come in and you say, I've talked to a couple people, and this is what it would cost to fix this deteriorated wall, and that should be factored in to my assessment, then those are the kinds of things that are persuasive to a citizen board like us.
Yes, and we're the first step, the Board of Assessors, before you get to meet Alan, who does a really fantastic job. And we're the same way. We first want to make sure that the factual information that we have relates to the property that you have. And we want to make at least those corrections and then focus on the market of what the property would sell for equalized at this point. And I think we had a lot of hands, but I want to go around the room appropriately. Sir?
Earlier on, you mentioned an example of a property. It was a deep property, but went off a cliff down into the Intervale, and it seemed to lower the value. Would the non-buildability of a part of the lot always lower the value? I have a significant part of my property that it's in the deed that nothing can be built.
Right.
And I don't think that's the same as the other properties anywhere around. I don't know if that is a plus or minus, or what to think about that.
Well,
would it be on the card? That's what I don't know. Also.
Well, you'd have to explain it more deeply. Yes, if you have a lot that you can't build on, it has a different value than a lot that can be built on. But sometimes someone might say, well, I have a right of way over the last 5 feet of my property. It's in the far back. There's nothing you're going to do anyways. It's like, well, maybe there's not much of an effect on that. So I think that they're kind of individual cases, but if it's significantly, if it's apparent that it is hindering something that could make the property better in a true way, then it has a big impact. But I've heard people say, well, I got this right away, it's on the last 3 feet of my property. I'd be like, well, that doesn't have much of an effect on the buildability, because you're not, it's just a reasonable thing.
Sorry.
It's a reason thing.
Would that factor beyond the property card?
Yeah, probably should be if it has an impact. Just like if you have a very steep bank, and we look at a lot, say if the lot is 5,000 square feet and the values of 5,000 square foot lots in this neighborhood are $100,000, and you have a lot that can hold a house and has a small backyard, but then the steep bank drops off, and so the lot is really, the usable part of the lot is smaller, there'd be a discount on that property.
Okay, thank you.
Okay.
Did the Lister card, was that introduced with this recent appraisal? Was that a new concept, or have Lister cards always been there?
Yeah, Vermonters like calling them Lister cards. I call them property data cards. There have been assessor cards. We've had property data online for probably 15 years now.
Yeah.
We print cards off if people ask. People used to come in, but now you get everything online. No, it's not a new thing. And if you go to Colchester or any other municipality, they would have Lister cards as well.
Now, was the grade and the condition and depreciation, was that there before, or did that change with this appraisal?
No, there's cost approach takes into consideration elements that make up value. And so that is not a new concept. It's been around even before I started this work. And so it's been something that's been around for a long time and has been applied to properties.
In my property, before the reappraisal, property was valued at about $600,000.
Uh-huh.
But this rating of, like, I got ended up with a rating of excellent. After that rating was put on, our property went to $1.1 million just for the reappraisal. And so it seemed to me that something wasn't there before, but was there afterwards, because $600,000 made sense, because that's about what it cost to build the house.
Yeah.
And I actually built the house, so I know that.
Good, you know a lot, yeah.
So it struck me as being a big shock and unfair to all of a sudden have $500,000 added to the value of our house just because it was newer.
I think I understand what happened here.
Yeah.
A lot of the data is the same data that was there prior to the reappraisal.
Right.
And the company that we hired re-examines everything. They go through and they redo based on multiple regression, based on building an algorithm, based on the sales. They rebuild the depreciation schedule as well as other things. And so it's a multiplicative formula where they might have a base cost and then they have a multipliers, pluses or minuses that make up the overall value. And their depreciation table, what might have been considered as X, we're talking about condition, right?
Yeah.
Excellent condition for an older house might have been something, if it's a significantly older house, might have been something around 10%, and then the new one might be like 3%. So there's the factor may be changing that. And so we've had to look at a lot of our appeals were based on folks that had done some work back in 2006, 2007, 2008, and we applied it and everyone thought it was totally fair and moved on. And then we do a reappraisal and the formula for depreciation is tweaked. And maybe that stuff that work that they did back in 2007, say, so to speak, is not so fresh and new, and it really should be closer to average good. So that's something that I've seen with appeals in our review.
It seems like that.
And that might be the case for you.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah.
Because we had an old house we had to tear down, completely eliminate, and built a new house. And we know exactly how much we spent.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, it seems like all the big jump was because of the excellent rating and the loss of any depreciation.
Well, you should come in. I think you are, have you filed an appeal?
I'm going to, yes.
Okay, you should do that. And also, if we have time, we'll do a review ahead of time. But file the appeal. I suggest everyone files their appeal because you can always withdraw it if we are able to attend and address the points that you're making.
Okay.
Anyone have any other questions? Or Alan, sorry.
Oh, my last part of that question was who decides what grade it is and what condition it is?
Well, at this point, our office does.
Your office.
Yep.
If it gets to us, we will.
Yeah, exactly. And then it goes.
And then the reappraisal was that done by the company, the consulting company?
Tyler. Yes.
Tyler Technologies. Yeah. They have a reappraisal division. They used to be Cold Air and Trumbull, and they made a lot of the decisions. Yeah. Obviously, we walked through the whole process with them. They had a modeler that has been doing it for many, many years.
Yeah.
He's done much bigger municipalities than Burlington. Hartford, Connecticut, Portland, Maine, like those types of places.
Yeah.
And I think he did a fantastic job. However, it's sometimes the data may be wrong about a particular property.
Mm.
And it may be wrong about a particular property that is down the road that everyone points to. Mm. So we get a lot of that.
Yeah.
Okay, a small point. I was on the website and I think that it shows the deadline for appeal for this round as the 20th.
Yeah,
it's
the 20th.
It is. Okay.
Yeah, it's okay, Alan.
It was the 19th.
No, no offense.
It's the 20th. No, that's you caught that. I was like, oh, I'll let that one go.
It's
if it was the other way around, I would have made a point, but it was in your favor, so.
I moved here 15 months ago. Right.
Congratulations.
Around time, my welcome was, here's your new assessment.
Mm-hmm.
And it was more than twice what the prior assessment was. So I looked at that and it was $70,000 more than I had paid for the house. So I made an appeal and I got back a denial of my appeal, but no explanation whatsoever. And then I called your office and spoke to a young man whose name I have written down. But they said, gee, like you said at your introduction, they generally provide some detail, some rationale for why they denied my appeal. But they didn't. And I sat around and waited for one and missed the deadline to go meet Alan. But I had submitted the HUD-1 form for my purchase and the Bank of America appraisal. So eventually somebody forwarded this to the manager of the Tyler company, who sent back an email, which got forwarded to me by your office, that said, oh, we didn't have to adjust this guy's assessed value because it was only 8% above the market value. And I looked at that and said, well, you know, I'm not happy to pay 8% more than the list price in a grocery store. Why am I paying 8% more that? And they said, oh, they don't have to adjust it unless it was 10% more than the market value. Where did those numbers come from? And the new assessment I got in the mail last week was based on the accuracy of last year's assessment, which I failed to appeal to Alan, because this cockamamie 8% is okay idea was what I heard from the manager of Tyler. So how can you make me happier?
Well, you should file your appeal and you should meet with us. That's their standards.
It wasn't a standard that you gave them.
No.
Up to 10% off is fine.
Didn't provide that. I'm wondering if it's also a market timing thing. But I don't know. You know, the market was increasing. It's been increasing for several years. We value by April, last year, valued by April 1st, 2021.
Mm-hmm.
So it might be a little bit of change from market appreciation over time. But that said, that's what they told you. That's their standard. And unfortunately, you didn't move forward. But you have the opportunity now, so I suggest that you take advantage of that now.
Right. So that even if my new assessment is based on a proper look at what happened in the last year,
we'll look,
it would be based on a bad starting point.
That's fine.
Okay.
We'll look at it all afresh and new.
If I can just point out, we are about to lose this room.
Okay.
Somebody has this room and talk and set up for the next one, so.
Okay.
Thank you all for coming, and I'm sure John will be available in the hall afterwards if you have any more specific questions.
Thanks, Alan. Great job.
Thanks.
Thank you, Alan.
Thank you, Alan.
Thank you.